On the 3rd of June, 1998, a family travelling on the high-speed train from Munich to Hamburg were shocked when a sharp strip of metal shot up through the floor of the train, embedding itself in the armrest between two seats. The occupants of the carriage fled along the train, with one of them hurrying to fetch the conductor. They may have felt relieved to have so narrowly avoided injury, but could not have known that as the train raced onwards towards its destination, they were just minutes away from one of the worst rail disasters in Germany's history. Germany has an extensive network of high-speed rail lines, lines which are served by specially built trains that can travel astonishingly fast. While ordinary passenger trains travel at speeds of under 160 kilometers or under 100 miles per hour, German high-speed trains on some lines are capable of traveling at 300 kilometers or 186 miles per hour. High-speed trains first began running in Germany in 1991. Japan had already developed high-speed rail with the Shinkansen, or bullet train, and Italy and France had soon followed suit with high-speed rail lines of their own. High-speed rail travel was generally seen as a boon for the economy. It was safe, relatively inexpensive for passengers, environmentally friendly when compared with other forms of transit, and above all, fast. Germany's high-speed trains were referred to as Intercity Express or ICE trains and were run by the state railway company Deutsche Bahn. In their early years, most passengers reported a generally positive experience. But there was one issue that many noticed. When travelling at high speeds on ICE trains, there would be a great deal of vibration, enough to cause knives and forks in the buffet car to rattle noisily, and glasses to move across the table of their own accord. The cause of this vibration was found to be the wheels. They were of standard monoblock design, where each wheel was cast as a single complete part. When in use, these wheels would wear down unevenly, something which, over time, resulted in vibrations that were transmitted up and into the carriages on which the wheels rode. To solve this problem, the wheel design was changed. The monoblock wheels were replaced by wheels that had several components: a central core, a metal tire that wrapped around the outside of the wheel, and a rubber damper between the two to reduce vibration. This type of wheel design had been successfully used on trams for many years. Engineers working for Deutsche Bahn calculated that these wheels would still be safe and functional at the much higher speeds of the ICE network. Tests were carried out, but some tests were cut short as Deutsche Bahn executives were keen to roll out the new design and resolve the vibration problem as quickly as possible. Once they did so in 1992, the new wheel design completely solved the vibration issue and appeared to work well for several years without any significant problems. In 1997, Ustra, a company responsible for running the trams in Hanover, noticed cracks in the wheels of some of their vehicles. While the components of any machine will wear down over time, these cracks were appearing much earlier than they had expected. Ustra quickly replaced the affected tires and adjusted their maintenance schedules so that tires would be replaced much more often, before cracks had any chance to form. Ustra also informed Deutsche Bahn of their findings, as they were aware that the same type of wheel was in use on high-speed trains. However, as Deutsche Bahn had not noticed any similar problems on their high-speed train wheels, no action was taken. On the 3rd of June 1998, an ICE train was travelling from Munich to Hamburg. At 10:30 a.m., it departed from the station in Hanover, the final intermediate stop before its destination. A little less than 20 minutes later, a powerful jolt rocked the first passenger car, and a sharp piece of metal exploded up through the floor, intruding into a compartment where passengers were seated. Passenger Jörg Dittmann was sitting with his family directly above the place where the piece of metal entered the carriage. Indeed, it pierced the armrest between his wife and his son. Jörg and his family quickly left their compartment and moved to the next carriage, while Jörg went to find a conductor. He found one in the third coach and quickly explained what he'd seen. Following his training, the conductor said that he would take a look at the damage. Per company policy, he could only initiate an emergency stop of the train after he had inspected the problem. He and Jörg returned to the first carriage, noting on the way that the train had begun to sway alarmingly as it raced along the rails at around 200 kilometers, or 124 miles per hour. Just as Jörg was about to point the conductor to the damage, the train violently derailed. The derailment began with the third car. The front motor car and passenger cars 1 and 2 survived intact, but the third carriage derailed and hit a bridge which passed over the track. The impact caused the bridge to begin to collapse. Car 4 was able to pass underneath the falling bridge before riding up into an embankment and crashing into some trees. Part of car 5 and all of car 6 were crushed by the falling bridge, compressed in places down to a height of just 6 inches. The subsequent cars piled into the wreckage at full speed, derailing and crashing into one another so violently that 8 carriages ended up occupying the same space that had, just moments ago, been occupied by one. 2 Deutsche Bahn railway workers who had been attending to a job underneath the bridge were instantly killed. Many of the passengers on board met a similar fate. While passengers in the first few cars, those that passed under the bridge before it collapsed, lived, the vast majority of those further back in the train stood little chance of survival. Locals from the nearby town of Eschede were drawn to the scene by the sound of the crash, with emergency services arriving just a few minutes later. More than 1,000 emergency workers converged on the crash site, including the police and the army. Around 40 emergency physicians were attending a conference nearby and travelled to the site to provide emergency care for the wounded. The rescue operation was a challenging one. There had never before been a serious accident involving an ICE train, and as such, none of the emergency workers had ever worked on one before. Now, as they tried to cut seriously injured people free of the wreckage, they found that the train's pressure-resistant windows and doors were extremely difficult to cut through. 87 people were treated for serious injuries, with many ferried to hospital by helicopter. In total, out of 287 passengers and 8 crew on board the train, 101 people died in the crash. Jörg Dittmann and his family escaped without serious injury, as did the conductor that Jörg informed about the damage to the train. At the time, high-speed rail in Germany had a reputation for being safe and efficient. The crash was, therefore, an immense shock, especially as no accident of comparable seriousness had yet taken place on high-speed networks anywhere in the world. The Fraunhofer Institute for Structural Durability and System Reliability, or Fraunhofer LBF, carried out the investigation into the cause of the crash. The sequence of events as determined by the Institute was this. The piece of metal that had been thrust up into the compartment occupied by Jörg Dittmann and his family had in fact been part of the metal tire that covered one wheel of that carriage. After having been worn down over time, the tire had broken, with some of the remains being propelled up into the carriage. The remains of the tire were stuck like a spear through the floor of the carriage. The tail end of it dragged on the ground below. As the train passed over a set of points, the tail end of the embedded tire made contact with the points, wrenching them out of alignment and partially derailing that set of wheels. The train continued along the tracks with one set of wheels partially derailed, causing the swaying motion that some passengers had noticed just before the crash. As it approached another set of points, one partially derailed wheel made contact with the points and altered their position, effectively changing the orientation of the points as the third car was passing over them. The rear wheels of the third car and every car which followed it were directed down a different track from the front motor car and cars 1 and 2. This caused car 3 to turn sideways and derail completely, smashing into the overpass and beginning the disaster that destroyed the rest of the train. it was found that there had been many opportunities to avert the accident. In 1992, Fraunhofer LBF had warned Deutsche Bahn of the possibility of tyres failing on high-speed trains. Likewise, in 1997, the tram company Ustra had also raised concerns about the durability of the wheels. Deutsche Bahn had acted on neither of these warnings. Further, it was found that the routine inspections of wheels had been carried out visually, using flashlights to look for cracks or signs of stress. Equipment specifically designed to detect metal fatigue was available, but was not used because this equipment was seen as being too sensitive, with a history of delivering what the company believed to be false positives. In the weeks leading up to the crash, complaints made by travellers of excess vibration on board some of the cars involved in the crash had been logged but not thoroughly investigated. The conductor who had not stopped the train was questioned, but later absolved of any blame. He had correctly followed procedures that he had been trained in. His job was primarily customer service, and he did not have the technical background to know whether emergency stop procedures were appropriate or not, or the standing within the company to change them if they were inappropriate. Deutsche Bahn accepted responsibility for the accident. A set amount of compensation was paid to the families of all those who had died or been injured, and further claims against the company were all settled out of court. Three employees of Deutsche Bahn, whose roles meant that they had some direct responsibility for the accident, faced criminal charges. All three cases were resolved with a plea bargain after a lengthy trial. The case was dismissed, and each of the accused ordered to pay a fine of €10,000. Many changes were made to the German rail network in the aftermath of the Eschede rail crash. Firstly, wheels on all high-speed trains were replaced with a monoblock design. The entire network was assessed to identify any other places where track points were situated just in front of bridges or other obstacles. And these points were, in most cases, moved. The pressure-proof windows and doors that had resisted cutting during the rescue operation were replaced with windows and doors that could be released or broken easily in the event of an emergency. A memorial to those who died in the crash was established in 2001. In a field close to the crash site, 101 cherry trees were planted, one for each person who had passed away. The names of the deceased are carved into a stone wall, and at the far end of the site, a stone staircase leads upwards to nowhere, ending in empty space.